All right, everyone, I've been super excited to bring you guys this market deep dive on California real estate biz. Let me tell you, even with all the issues the state is facing and the sky-high real estate prices across California, I still think there are some cities, some counties, some metro areas across the state that represent intriguing investment potential here in mid-2021 if you're a home buyer or a real estate investor. And I know more generally a lot of you have soured on California as an investment market, and I don't blame you, right? I mean, we have a huge exodus of people out of the state. In fact, almost 500,000 more people have moved out of the state than moved in since 2015. That's not good for real estate. Prices are already really high. That's not good for real estate. But not every city is like this. There are actually some diamond in the rough markets in California that buck the trend, that actually have good migration, that have affordable prices, that actually don't build too much new housing, and thus might be a good option for you as a home buyer or real estate investor here in mid-2021. So what I'm going to do in this video is give you guys the real-time data on this. I'm going to show you, to start with, migration patterns county by county across the state. What are the counties where people are moving to? What are the counties where people are moving away from? Then we're going to look at home price appreciation historically. Then we're going to look at housing supply expansion, or are certain areas overbuilding or underbuilding? And finally, we're going to have some general recommendations about the cities and the markets that you should target as a home buyer or real estate investor right now in mid-2021. Let's get into the data, guys. And where we're gonna start here is with a map. And on this map, we're looking at every county in California. There's 58 different counties. And there's a color coding on this map. And that color coding shows the migration levels into and out of these counties over the last 5 years. This is data that comes from the US Census Bureau migration estimates. And I want you to pay attention in particular to the color coding here on this map. The redder the county looks, the more people that are moving out. The bluer the county looks, the more people that are moving in. And if the county looks gray, it's kind of in between. And we're looking at a metric here called migration percentage. And so what that is, we're taking the total net migration over the last 5 years, people moving in minus people moving out, and we're dividing that by the existing population. So you can get a sense of how much of the existing population comes from migration. And the first place I want to start is here in the Bay Area in Northern California, because you can see a whole lot of red here in the Bay Area. I mean, if we go to San Francisco County, over the last 5 years, San Francisco County has lost 10,000 people due to migration. That's a roughly 1.2% decline of its population due to migration. That's not very good. That means more people are moving out than moving in. But 1.2% actually isn't that bad compared to the 3.3% in San Mateo County, or the 3.4% in Santa Clara County, which is technically in the San Jose Metro. These areas here are seeing massive outflows of people due to negative migration. And then if we go up further north to Marin, Sonoma, and Napa, these counties are also around -2% to -3% in migration over the last 5 years. And this Bay Area region has some of the biggest outward flows of people of anywhere in the US. So when you hear California exodus, I want you to think of the Bay Area. Now, of course, not all the areas in Northern California are like this. If we just scroll a little bit east, we can start to see a lot of blue. For instance, San Joaquin County in Stockton has seen positive inward migration of 25,000 people. That's plus 3.2% growth of its population due to migration. If we go up to Sacramento, plus 1.9%. And if we kind of go east of the Central Valley here to Amador County, El Dorado, Placer County, we're seeing some crazy migration numbers, plus 4%, plus 5%, plus 9% in some of these counties over here. So in Northern California, I want you to understand that the Bay Area and the western side is losing people. The Central Valley and the eastern side is gaining people. If you guys are enjoying the data in this video and find it useful and helpful, just make sure to hit that like button. I spend a lot of time putting this content together and sharing with you. In return, when you hit the like button, it just gets me more exposure on YouTube and actually allows me to produce more of this content going forward. Additionally, I'd like you to comment on the video. I want to hear your feedback, especially if you're on the ground in California. What are you seeing as a buyer and a renter? When you guys comment, it makes these videos better. All right, let's get back to it. The other area we need to look at is Southern California, scrolling down to LA. Because LA has lost a massive amount of people over the last 5 years. We're seeing -380,000, which is the most negative migration of any county in the US, -380,000, which is -3.8% loss to its population. And we can see that surrounding counties like Orange County and Ventura are similar, losing a lot of people. Where are they going? Well, one area is Riverside County to the east. Riverside County has actually gained 85,000 people due to positive migration over the last 5 years, plus 3.4%. And so this is a great place to get started in terms of understanding the type of real estate markets that you want to invest in California in mid-2021, because migration is a huge ingredient of real estate demand. I mean, if you have people moving in, right, especially if you have more people moving in than how many housing units are being built, that's going to lead to upward pressure on home prices, upward pressure on rents, and good returns for you as a homeowner or real estate investor. On the other side of the spectrum, if a lot of people are moving out, right, if there's more outward migration than inward migration, that's going to be a problematic for your real estate market at a certain point. And I'm predicting places like Los Angeles and San Francisco, which have been losing a lot of people, their real estate markets are going to struggle at some point because of that. They haven't struggled quite yet, but they will, because you ultimately need bodies, you need people to fill these apartment units and these housing units. And for that reason, places like Sacramento, places like Stockton, places like Riverside could theoretically be intriguing investment options for you here in mid-2021 in California. Of course, guys, that's not all we need to look at. We need to understand also risk factors associated with these markets. And one of the ways I like to understand this is to get some historical perspective. And to get that, let's go back to the last housing crash, 2007 to 2012. How did these markets behave in that last crash? Because that's going to be an important pointer for how they might behave in the next crash, which if you've watched my videos, you know I think that we're on the doorstep of a big housing crash here in America. And I think California certainly could be in the crosshairs of that crash. So to understand, you know, the security of the market you're buying in, which I'm sure a lot of you care about, we need to understand the historical security of these markets. And let's do that right now. And so what we're looking at on this graph is a bunch of red bars. And what do these red bars correspond to? Well, they correspond to the decline in home prices in markets across California from 2007 to 2012, in the middle of the last housing crash. And the one thing to take away from this, guys, is that pretty much every market in California got hit hard in that last housing crash. You can see this yellow line represents the US average decline, which was 22%. For the typical market. Well, every market here represented in California was above that US average decline. And just important to understand that, because I think some people have this false perspective that California is somehow insulated from a real estate crash, like it just can't happen to California. Definitely not true. I mean, it happened really severely in the last crash. And it's useful to understand where it happened. So we can see San Jose experienced a 27% decline in home prices during the last crash. So typical home price in San Jose went from $825,000 to $600,000 roughly. And that's a big, big decline, especially in nominal dollars. That was $220,000 off the value of a typical home. San Francisco experienced a 30% decline. The typical price went from $761 to $531. San Diego was minus 33%. LA was minus 36%. And Ventura was minus 38%. So all of these high-priced coastal areas kind of roughly had a 30 to 35% decline. Now, if we kind of keep going down this list, we could see that the declines got even worse as we went further inland into the Central Valley. I mean, a place like Sacramento got hit by a 47% decline in home prices in the last crash. I mean, that's an absolutely brutal decline, nearly 50% wiped off homeowner wealth and value in Sacramento. It gets even worse if we go to Riverside, which experienced a 51% decline in prices. And then even worse if we go to Stockton, which was literally, I think, next to Modesto, which you can see right next to it, was the second worst hit housing crash, housing market in America in the last housing crash, minus 61% in Stockton. So we can actually see that the markets that we just identified as high migration markets in California, you know, people moving into these markets like Stockton and Riverside, it's not so good when we look at their real estate history. These were markets that actually got hit really, really hard in the previous housing crash, even worse than the LAs or the San Franciscos of the world. So that causes some concern, potentially, if you're a real estate investor or home buyer. And I know a lot of people like to sweep the last housing crash under the rug at this point. I see it all the time in the comments section. People say, oh, we're not gonna have another housing crash in 2021 or 2022, because you know the last crash was caused by subprime loans, and you know that was just something completely different, and we don't have subprime loans now, so the argument goes, and that we won't have a crash. But guys, I disagree wholeheartedly with that. Subprime loans were kind of a factor in the last crash, but they weren't the main factor. Actually, in fact, a market like San Francisco and San Jose had almost no subprime loans, had very, very few, and yet they still declined by 30 to 35%. And so there was something more broadly that happened in California during the last housing crash, and that was quite simply that, one, home prices accelerated way above local wages, right? And a lot of people got priced out of the market. And when that happens, it, you know, creates downside in the housing market. But the other thing that happened in California 15 to 20 years ago was that there was a lot of new home building going on, especially in markets like Riverside and Stockton. They were throwing up new homes and apartments left and right in these markets. And when you build a lot of new housing supply, you run the risk of entering a housing glut, where there's more homes and apartments than there are people available to live in them. And during like the bubble going up, the housing glut might not appear so obvious. It might appear like, oh, there's so much demand, et cetera, et cetera. But if you're permitting and building more homes than, say, jobs are being created or people are migrating to the city, that type of housing glut can create a big downside risk. So the other thing we need to look at now to understand whether a place like Riverside or Stockton is still risky today or as big of a risk as it was 15 years ago is to look at how much new housing is getting built. Because that supply side of the equation, you know, new homes, new apartments, is really, really important in understanding the downside risk factors in markets today. And so that's what we're looking at on this graph. And I know it looks like just a bunch of jumbly lines and you might want to look away, but don't look away. I'll explain what this means. Each line represents a different metro across California over the last 25 years. And the metric we're looking at here is called permit percentage. So we're looking at the amount of permits pulled for new homes and apartments over the preceding 12 months. And we're dividing it by the total jobs in the local economy. And so this gives us a good relative sense of how much new housing is getting built for the size of these economies. And the one thing that just sticks out like a sore thumb is that back in 03, 04, 05, way more new homes and apartments were being permitted for construction than there are today. And like, for instance, if we go to Riverside, back in, let's just say, March 05 in Riverside, 55,000 permits had been pulled for construction over the previous 12 months, and Riverside had 1.2 million jobs. So that was a permit percentage of 4.5% in Riverside at the peak of the last housing bubble. And when that bubble crashed, you know, the permitting and construction crashed, and it really never rebounded. So we can actually see today Riverside's permit percentage in 2021 is 1.1%. 16,000 permits have been pulled on a total job count of 1.5 million. So Riverside today is building and permitting four times less new housing than it was prior to the last housing crash. Stockton's a similar situation, where Stockton was around a 4% permit percentage prior to the last crash. And then today, it's around a 1.3% permit percentage. And you could see a similar story with Bakersfield, Sacramento, and Fresno. These markets, which were building a lot back then, are no longer building a lot. Now, what's interesting too is that if we were to look at some of the coastal markets like San Jose, you could see San Jose's permit percentage just never was that high. It was only around 0.5%. You know, you could see even in the peak of the last bubble, San Jose was only permitting around 6,800 units for construction, 0.8%. And today, San Jose is around 0.7%. And a similar story for San Francisco and San Diego. So the coastal markets, the dense coastal markets in California are building like a little bit less, but roughly the same amount of housing that they were 15 to 20 years ago. But kind of the growth Central Valley markets like Riverside and Stockton and Bakersfield are building way less housing than they were 15 years ago. And you can see that basically by the fact that all these lines now in 2021 for each market are pretty close together. And this makes me more bullish on places like Riverside and Stockton now, because I think a big factor in the price declines in those markets 15 years ago was the fact that their permit percentages were like 3%, 4%, and they were just throwing up new homes left and right. And when the bubble burst, they had all this supply and there was no one really there to live in it. And so I don't think those Central Valley markets and those more inland markets are as at risk now of that same type of decline, because quite simply the supply isn't there. There's much more of a housing shortage than there is a housing glut. And this actually presents an interesting conundrum, right? Because, you know, builders should be wanting to build in these markets. And, you know, especially in places like Bakersfield or Stockton, it's pretty easy to build. Like, land is flat. There's plenty of developable land available for sale. It's not like San Francisco, where there's like all this topography and geography and density. Pretty easy to build in Bakersfield or Stockton if you wanted, but the builders just aren't going there. And part of me wonders whether they still kind of feel hurt from the last crash and skeptical. Part of me wonders if a lot of like the local builders just went out of business and never came back. I actually think a more broad situation going on is that a lot of, especially national builders, just don't want to build in California because of the negative government policies towards, you know, home builders and real estate developers. Permit fees are really high. Impact fees are really high. If you build a multifamily community, you're subject to rent control, and you can only increase your rent by so much. And so I think California's negative state policies are actually driving out a lot of developers from the market. And that's bad for California from a society perspective, but it's good if you're an existing real estate owner or a soon-to-be real estate owner, because it likely means that in the long run, there's just going to be a perpetual housing shortage across the market. And this is something that Gavin Newsom pledged to fix when he was elected governor. And in fact, it's only gotten worse since he was elected governor. The amount of permits pulled across California has actually gone down over the last 3 years. So whatever he's doing to try to stimulate building, it's not really working. And this is a problem for the state as a whole, but like I said, could be good if you're a real estate investor. Now, the last thing I want to touch upon here from a data perspective, so you guys have all the, you know, data you need to make a decision about where in California you want to buy or invest, is affordability. The ratio of home prices to wages in the local economies, because this was a big predictive factor prior to the last housing crash of which cities crashed the most. The ones where home prices escalated above local wages were the ones where prices dipped the most during the crash. And that makes sense, because if prices go way above wages, you know, how are locals affording the homes? Like, they're not going to afford the homes at some point, and the prices are going to come down to a level that locals can afford. So for this, we need to look at a ratio and a statistic that I call value to earnings ratio. We're taking the typical home price in the market as reported by Zillow, and we're dividing it by the annual earnings of the typical worker, which is data that comes from the BLS. And this is super revealing about which markets in California offer bang for your buck and affordability. So that's what we're looking at on this graph, value to earnings ratio. And you can see that this is a number that kind of goes from 1 to, you know, potentially 18 across California for each market. And you can see how the value to earnings ratio by these markets has changed across time. But let's start with an example so you can better understand it. San Francisco, as of May 2021, had a typical home price of $1.25 million. And the typical earnings of the average worker were $80,000. Now, $80,000 is actually very high for average worker earnings, but it's not even really close to high enough to justify the home prices. So the typical price is 15.7 times what those annual earnings are. And you can see in San Francisco that it was at a similar level prior to the last housing crash in January 07. And then when that last housing crash took hold, value to earnings in San Francisco collapsed all the way below 10. And now they're back at 15 or 16. I wonder what that means about where values in San Francisco are heading. Similar situation exists in San Jose, where in San Jose, the average annual earnings of the typical worker are $92,000 compared to a typical home price of $1.38. That's a 15x value to earnings ratio. And that's actually substantially above what it was prior to the last housing crash, where it was 13x. And then it went from 13x to 8x at the bottom of the last housing crash. And remember, San Francisco and San Jose, these were markets that had very minimal exposure to subprime, yet they still collapse in terms of value to earnings ratio. So I don't like these markets given how high the value to earnings is. LA and San Diego are kind of a tier down. They're around that 12 value to earnings ratio, but they're still pretty expensive. So I would have a difficult time justifying buying in those markets given how high those VE ratios are. But then we start getting more reasonable. Stockton, Riverside, and Sacramento are around 9-to-1 value to earnings. Fresno is around 6.6-to-1, and then Bakersfield is a 5-to-1. Bakersfield actually offers by far the most potential value for homeowners and real estate investors in California based on that ratio between home prices and earnings. So putting all of this data together, the historical migration data where people are moving, looking at the historical price declines, looking at how many new permits are being pulled, and looking at the value to earnings ratio, I think there's really three markets across California that come out to me as like the top three in terms of their combination of growth potential and investment security right now. And those three markets are Sacramento, Bakersfield, and Riverside. I feel like these markets have the best combination of factors here for mid-2021, where if you do feel like you wanna buy now, if you're a home buyer and investor, I think these are markets in California that could give you the best future growth potential / investment security. Now, I gotta caveat that, generally speaking, I think we're in a housing bubble. So buying now, I believe, is risky in general. And if you buy now, even in these markets, you could still experience price declines going forward, right? But just looking at things like migration and how much new housing there is, I think, you know, you would be safer potentially buying here than in a place like LA or San Francisco. The other caveat I'll give, guys, is that, you know, real estate is hyper-local. So even in these markets, there could be neighborhoods that aren't as good, and certainly, you know, properties that present issues. I have noticed on Zillow quite a bit of like flipping that's occurring in some of these markets and speculation. And that's probably something you don't want to get involved in. So even if you like the market more generally, make sure to do your specific due diligence on your neighborhood and on your specific property to make sure that you're getting into a good situation. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I know a lot of you out there, a lot of my viewers, you live in California. In fact, according to YouTube, 23% of my views come from California. So I wanted to make this video for you guys and to give you kind of the data and the information from my perspective on how the market looks. And if you appreciate that, just give this video a like. If you already gave the video a like, don't undo your previous one. But if you haven't, give the video a like, and also make sure to comment. I want to hear your perspective, you know, especially people on the ground in California. What are you seeing in these markets as a buyer or renter? When you guys comment, it makes these videos better. All right, guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. Why don't you subscribe and stick around for Friday? I got a video dropping on the mortgage lending crisis going on in America. Put simply, banks are not lending right now. Their lending standards are at like 2013 hyper strict levels. And I think those strict lending standards could actually crash the housing market. So I'm gonna have a video on that on Friday. If you're not subscribed yet, make sure to subscribe so you don't miss that video. All right, until then, this is Nick from ReVenture Consulting signing off.